Morning, Saints and Sinners. Welcome to Eureka Springs United Methodist Church. Today we're talking about peace, Paul's metaphor of the shoes, shields, and swords. We hope that this service brings you much joy and comfort in your daily life. But welcome and thank you for joining us.
As we gather, may your Spirit work within us. As we gather, may we glorify your name, knowing well that as our hearts begin to worship, we'll be blessed because we came. As we gather, may your Spirit work within us. As we gather, may we glorify your name, knowing well that as our hearts begin to worship, we'll be blessed because we came.
May we pray. Holy Father, thank you for this day. In our many prayers, we ask for guidance, leadership, and wisdom to do your work where we live and where we work. Often we don't say the kindest words or act in the most caring manner, and yet you forgive us and urge us to try again. When Jesus was about to send his disciples out into their world, he gave them explicit instructions on where to go, what work they were to do, how to judge the places and the people that they would encounter. Help us to remember those guidelines. Imprint them on our hearts and minds. Then we will be more effective in caring and loving all those we meet. May the Holy Spirit always be at our sides to nudge us in the right direction. We offer all these pleas through the prayer that your Son, Jesus Christ, taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Holy Spirit, thou art welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, thou art welcome in this place. Omnipotent Father of mercy and grace, Holy Spirit, in this place. Holy Spirit, thou art welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, thou art welcome in this place. Omnipotent Father of mercy and grace, thou art welcome in this place. When you're up against a struggle that shatters all your dreams, and your hopes been cruelly crushed by Satan's manifested scheme, and you feel the urge within you to submit to earthly fears, don't let the faith you're standing in seem to disappear. Praise the Lord. praise Him, praise Him, Lord. For our God inhabits praise, praise the Lord. For the chains that seem to bind you serve only to remind you that they draw powerless behind you when you praise Him. Now Satan, he's a liar, and he wants to make us think that we are paupers, when he knows himself we're children of the King. So lift up the mighty shield of faith, for the battle must be won. We know that Jesus Christ is risen, so the work's already done. Praise the Lord, He can work through those who praise Him. Praise the Lord, for a God inhabits praise. Praise the Lord, for the chains that seem to bind you serve only to remind you that they drop powerless behind you when you praise Him. Praise the Lord, He can work through those who praise Him. Praise the Lord, for our God inhabits praise. Praise the Lord, for the chains that seem to bind you serve only to remind you that they drop powerless behind you when you praise Him. When you praise Him. When you praise the Lord.
The scripture reading today, that is according to the Common English Bible, comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 10, verses 7 through 19. As you go, make this announcement: the kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those with skin diseases, and throw out demons. You received without having to pay. Therefore, give without demanding payment. Workers deserve to be fed, so don't gather gold or silver or copper coins for your money belts to take on your trips. Don't take a backpack for the road, or two shirts or sandals or a walking stick. Whatever city or village you go into, find somebody in it who is worthy, and stay there until you go on your way. When you go into a house, say peace. If the house is worthy, give it your blessing of peace. But if the house isn't worthy, take back your blessing. If anyone refuses to welcome you or listen to your words, shake the dust off your feet as you leave that house or that city. I assure you that it will be more bearable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on Judgment Day than it will be for that city. Look, I'm sending you as sheep among wolves. Therefore, be wise as snakes and innocent as doves. Watch out for people, because they will hand you over to councils and they will beat you in their synagogues. They will haul you in front of governors and even kings because of me, so that you may give your testimony to them and to the Gentiles. Whenever they hand you over, don't worry about how to speak or what you say, because what you can say will be given to you at that moment. Thanks be to God for the gift of the scriptures. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
May we pray. God, use these words of ours to proclaim your peace, your truth, your love. Use how we worship to spread your love through all the world. And may these scriptures that we've read inspire us to become the people that you've always wanted us to be. In your holy and precious name we pray. Amen. Well, I'll be honest with you. This sermon is to be about peace, And after dealing with technology that works as well as a 1950s Christmas tree, I am so rattled and so angry. It's ironic that I'm going to have to do a sermon on the feeling of peace. So if you will give me some good prayers of serenity now. Paul's metaphor of the Roman soldier is often not only taken out of context, but it's used the wrong way. It's used in a very militant way. I've been in churches and I've seen sermons where the preacher comes dressed up as a Roman soldier brandishing the sword, and the message becomes about the military might and has nothing to do with what Paul's talking about. Paul just used a common image in his world, the Roman soldier, to teach us about some profound truths. One of the clothing items he tells us to put on is shoes. And shoes, swords, and shields will all relate together, you'll see. But if you'll notice in the scripture, Paul says, put on the shoes, whatever shoes make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. Whatever shoes you're comfortable with. You like wearing combat boots, you like wearing flip-flops, sandals, whatever. Whatever it is gets you ready and out the door to go proclaim peace, put it on, because that's your mission, to go proclaim the gospel of peace. Now, the problem with English when we read the Bible in English is that we grow so used to these words that we hear all the time, like love and grace and peace and spirit, that we allow our culture to define them more than the Bible. And it always pays off, if you're studying the Bible, to go back and look up the original word. How do they translate peace into English? Because, you know, like we discovered last week, sometimes our word comes from the Latin, and sometimes our word comes from the Greek. And that's a huge difference of culture, how they approach things. For instance, the Latin word for peace is paxa. You ever heard of the Roman paxa? The Americana, pax Americana, things like that. That's a noun. It means the absence of conflict. And there was an old saying in the Roman Empire, the Romans were great at making peace. They came in, they leveled your home, made it a desert, and proclaimed peace. Nobody stood against them. Hey, we're all getting along now. Isn't that great? And isn't that how we try to live in peace? When somebody disagrees with us, we beat them over the head until they agree with us, and now we're at peace. Isn't that how we deal with family members, friends, neighbors? Get them to agree with me, and we're all going to get along, right? That's called peace. However, in Greek, the Greek word is eroneia, and it's more of an action. And some of you who like weaving, I know some of you are here, Grace, it's a word that comes from weaving. There's an image in Greek mythology of your life being woven together, many threads being woven together to make your life. And at the end of your life, one of the Greek goddesses takes the scissors and snips the thread, and your life is over. Your tapestry is woven. You're done. There's also another image of how people can come and pull a single thread from your life and start to unravel you. There's also an image of how community is to work. Peace in Greek is literally the weaving together of people into a community. All the different colored threads, the types of threads, all being woven together into a single tapestry. And that's what peace is. It's that continual work of weaving together. It has nothing to do with the absence of conflict. It's simply taking one thread after another and weaving them together. And each thread is different, different texture, different color, but they're woven together to make one beautiful tapestry. Of course, what happens in life when you weave people together? that can easily become unraveled, can it? One thread can be pulled and the whole mess will come unraveled. I remember at a military function, I was in my dress whites and I had one of those pennants flying, one of the threads popping out of my uniform, and my close friend came, "Hey, I'll take care of that." She pulled it. Well, she starts unraveling my uniform and left a hole. Peace is weaving together of people. It's not the absence of conflict. It is the constant work of working together. Now, that's a problem, isn't it? Because you put together a bunch of people, we all have different opinions and ideas and beliefs, and we all have different temperaments, and when you put us together, sometimes it's like a bunch of cats being thrown together, and we're more likely to fight one another than we are to weave each other together. But Paul says that's the problem, all right, but that's your job, to weave each other together in peace. Find a way to look past your disagreements, your opinions, your arguments. Find a way to look past how you find each other disagreeable and build a community. Now that's how the church was supposed to be, and for the first 300 years we were great at this. If you go look at the history of the early church, it's actually very remarkable. Men and women were both serving as leaders. People from around the Roman Empire of all different creeds and races and colors, social status, they all came together in one room, slaves and free, rich and poor. They came together and somehow they made it work because they worked on peace. They worked on weaving it together to making one community. And that's why the early church was so successful, was because everybody had a place and everybody were made to feel welcome and they were made to feel important because the community made sure everyone was woven together in its tapestry. Now, I'll be honest, I think we've totally forgotten how to weave. I think we've totally lost that art. You know, social media, that's a cesspool. How easy it is to get on there and you block and you unfriend people you don't like, people you disagree with, until eventually you've created your own little bubble of like-minded people. And then you have what you think is peace. But what you really have is everybody who thinks and acts just like you. And you've eliminated everybody else. And you've not really created a community at all. You've created yourself. Now, before social media came along, the church in America was doing that for 300 years. We would gather together, and if I didn't like you, and if I didn't like the way you preached or what you believed, I left and I went down the street and started my own church and gathered people just like me. And in America, the problem with Christianity is that we have thousands of these little churches that don't like each other, so they went down the street and started their own group of like-minded people. And we failed to build community. with weaving people together is I've got to figure out not only how to like you, how to love you, how to get along with you, but somehow we got to make this relationship work. And in a world where political and religious divisiveness is so prevalent, that's hard. Because we don't know how to manage conflict. We don't know how to manage disagreement. I don't know how to sit down and break bread with you, you who sit on the opposite end of the theological spectrum or the political spectrum. Because deep down, I don't want to. And Paul says, that's your problem. You haven't geared up yet. You haven't armored up. And I'm telling you, you've got to do this because we're fighting a battle out there. And we're fighting these spiritual forces that are tearing apart our country, our culture, our world. Spiritual forces that are using our disagreements and our anger to pit each other against one another. To try to boil it over into a war or into violence. And Paul says, get back to basics. Figure out how to live in peace again. Christians today are terrible at that. We've been taught all of our lives, don't rock the boat. Don't make people mad. And what we are really doing is we're never resolving conflict. We're never sitting down with the person that we're mad at or we're offended or they've offended us, and we never break bread with them and try to work it out because it's easier just to cut them out of our lives. I mean, think of the people Jesus wove into his tapestry. Judas Iscariot, the guy that betrayed him, probably a terrorist. Simon the Zealot, I mean, that's a religious fundamentalist, and Jesus is pretty progressive. Simple fishermen, prostitutes, tax collectors, people that were called sinners. Jesus took all those people and wove them together in a community somehow. He made them into a church, an ecclesia, a group of people that saw past their conflicts and their disagreements and they made it work. How did he do that? Because he was willing to love them. To see them as individuals, not as an opponent. Paul says, pick up your shield to resist the flaming arrows that will come at you. You know, the hate speech, the insults, you know, the things that get our ire up when people say something we don't like. Paul says, you basically need to have a little thicker skin. Don't let people get to you. They're still people worthy of being loved. And no matter how much you want to wring their little necks, that's just you having a thin skin. Toughen it up. Because loving people isn't for sissies. Paul says to take the sword of God's word. Now what does that mean? The word of God. The gospel of peace. You know, in the Greek, peace, the word peace had a little sister that was called justice. You cannot have peace without justice, according to the Bible. One requires the other. And when Paul says, put on those shoes and put on that shield and get that sword and go proclaim peace, he's also meaning you go stand up for justice. Think of our own history, of the people who geared up for God. Think of Martin Luther King and all the civil rights leaders who geared up and they marched for peace. It wasn't quite the peace we imagined as they were beaten and bludgeoned and sprayed with fire hoses and attacked with dogs and left for dead. But they spoke truth to power and they demanded if there is to be peace in this country, there must also be racial justice. Gandhi, too, did the same thing with his march to the sea. He wasn't violent, but they were violent to him. But he said, there can be no peace without justice. We Christians need to understand that peace is not simply some willy-nilly feeling we have. It's a work. It means speaking truth to power. It means creating a world where everyone is able to be woven together. If we let a single thread be cast aside, that's not peace, because that's not justice. All must be woven as one in Christ. For peace to truly exist, there also must be justice. Now, we like to come to church. We like to do our church thing. We like to pretend we're all lovey-dovey. But let's be honest. Isn't it hard getting along with each other? Isn't it hard getting along with your pastor? Thank God you all have masks on. Isn't it hard to go out in life and think, God, that person that drives me crazy, that gets on my very last nerve, somehow I'm supposed to take that thread and weave it into my community of faith? That's where the work of Christ gets hard. Because we're about the people who make peace. We make peace with one another. We make peace with this world. We sit down. We break bread together. We weave our lives together. And that means sitting down and taking each other seriously. Boy, I'll be honest, that just seems overwhelming right now. In a world that is so divided, where so much has been said and done that I just don't want to forgive, really. And yet God tells me, yep, that's the very person you need to go talk to. That's the person you need to make peace with. The person you need to understand, you need to love, you need to embrace. And I'm like, okay, I guess I'll dust off my feet and I'll go. Because the alternative is letting those spiritual powers of darkness rip us apart, to destroy our community, to destroy our nation, to destroy our community of faith. Someone has to proclaim peace. Someone has to practice the art of love. May we pray. God, it's difficult living in this world with people who are so disagreeable, with people who entertain ideas and opinions that are so anathema to my own. And yet, God, you told us this was the very community we were to create, a community where there were no more Jews or Gentiles, Greeks or free, rich or poor, male or female. There was simply a group of people created and shaped and molded by your hands. And you've taught us that we will know true love when we can finally look into the eyes of a stranger, into the eyes of an enemy, a neighbor, and see a child of God worthy of our love. God, truly peace does begin with me, with the choice that I make to go out, to talk, to break bread, to sit with, to listen, to understand those most foreign to my life. God, take these threads of peace and take these threads of our lives, and by your grace and by your love, help us to weave them all together, the many strands, the many colors, until we can create that beautiful tapestry that's called your kingdom, your community of faith. Then we will know peace and love will reign. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Remember your baptism, your calling. We are called to go and to make peace with the world, peace with one another, to work for justice and for love, to all have a place at this table. God pours out His love while we were yet sinners, so that we might be blessed by new life and a chance to follow Him. Come and follow Jesus again. Dip your hands in the water. Remember your baptism. Make that ancient sign of the cross. Remember who you are. Remember your calling. In a few moments, we will celebrate Holy Communion. Remember who Jesus invited to that table. The people had rejected them, but Jesus told them, "Through you I will build my kingdom." And so came the simple fishermen, the tax collectors, the prostitutes, the people the world called sinners. And Jesus sat them at His table, and He took the loaf of bread, and He gave thanks to His Father in heaven. And breaking the bread, He gave it to each of them with these words, "Take and drink, take and eat. This is my body, which I break for you. Do this in remembrance of me." As they each ate that evening, Jesus would take and pour a cup of wine. It's always important to pick the right pitcher. He would bless it, and He would give it to all with these words, "Drink from this cup, all of you. This is the cup of life that I pour out for you and for many for the forgiveness of your sins." May we pray. God, wherever we are this day, as we place before you our gifts of bread and wine, we pray that you would pour out your Holy Spirit upon these gifts to make them become for us the body and the blood of Christ Jesus, His life, His Spirit, and His grace. Fill us with your peace so that we may go out into this world to proclaim it, to share it, and to weave it. God, this is our holy calling, to build that community where all have a place at your table. No matter our disagreements, no matter our creeds, let peace begin with us so that love may reign forever and ever. In your holy and precious name we pray. Amen. Wherever you are, simply break off a piece of the bread and dip it in the cup to receive communion. May God fill your hunger, quench your thirst, and leave you a heart full of peace and of love. Amen.
Let's receive the benediction. Go in peace, and may the good Lord bless and keep you. May the good Lord bless till we meet, till we